Good morning.
Good morning.
And I know that we have a large crowd here this morning. The snow is probably a little bit of that. There are also basketball tournaments going on around the peninsula and all those kinds of things that are happening. Some people may even be watching March Madness or trying to. As we come this morning, and I'm going to lift this up this week, and I'm going to bring it again next week. This is the Sunday that is called Umcore Sunday, or it used to be called One Great Hour of Sharing. They've changed it since it was all about Umcore anyways, and people would always say, what is One Great Hour of Sharing about? We're going to see a short video on it in just a moment, but there should be offering envelopes and information in your bulletin, and we invite you to share in that. One thing, well, I'll let the video tell you about it. Don't forget that we are continuing in Readers for Leaders until through Easter morning. And on Easter morning, you'll have an opportunity to bring your reading gift into worship with you. It is also with Umcore Sunday that we are kicking off our winter / spring collection for cleaning buckets, cleaning kits, and this time we are going to be kicking off the hygiene and health kits. We will have all of those lists next week. This week got kind of crazy because I had some appointments that took me out of the office for the day, and I just forgot to get them out for Renee to put together. Leadership board meeting is actually on March 28th. I think, or maybe that is this week. It is. I got to get it back on my calendar. So it's this Wednesday, this Tuesday. Everything else, there's the Lenten prayer study is continuing. You can either watch it on Zoom or come in and join me. This week we will be looking at contemplative prayer, which is an interesting style of prayer that we'll hear about this morning. And it looks like an April newsletter is due. With those notes, I invite us to watch the video on Umcore, and then we'll go from there and begin our service.
Every day, in places all around the world, disaster strikes. Families struggle. Homes and livelihoods are destroyed. People don't know where to turn. Hope is almost lost. And then, by the grace of God and through the support of people like you, Umcore provides hope and healing to communities devastated by disasters. Part of the General Board of Global Ministries, Umcore is a humanitarian relief arm of the United Methodist Church. Working in the U.S. and in countries around the world, Umcore offers help when natural or man-made disasters overwhelm a local community's ability to respond, and seeks to improve the well-being of displaced peoples, migrants, and refugees. In the U.S., Umcore partners with United Methodist annual conferences, working with disaster response coordinators, disaster response ministries, and early response teams to provide support for relief and recovery efforts. By working together with U.S. conferences, Umcore's connectional approach helps communities recover faster and make survivors' lives whole again. Umcore also responds to international disasters, providing a range of relief and recovery support through local Methodist churches and trusted partners, as well as ecumenical and non-governmental organizations. Umcore's efforts to help communities become more self-sufficient and better prepared for future disasters include care for the environment and sustainable agriculture. Every day, around the world, Umcore Corps connects United Methodist churches to God's mission by helping people who are suffering. As followers of Christ, we are called to protect the vulnerable, support the weak, and comfort those who mourn. To learn more or to give to UmCorps, visit umcorps.org.
Taken on UmCorps Sunday. When it was started right after World War II, there were enough apportionments already. Can you imagine that they didn't believe that they wanted to add more apportionments to our budgets? So they said, we're going to allow UmCorps to be completely self-standing in what we can do with the offering taken on Then One Great Hour Sharing, now is UmCorps Sunday, pays for all of our staff on the national and international level that go in and find out what is taking place so that then the volunteers can go in. Every dollar that we give to any disaster relief, specific through UmCorps, goes directly to that. None of that goes towards any of our administration or that work. And most of us who work with UmCorps are volunteers. In fact, somebody asked me when we went after Hurricane Sandy to Long Island to work on homes that were hit, we got stuck in a snowstorm in Pennsylvania. And a man came up to me and said, "What is that trailer that you're?" Because I went out and I got bored because we were 4 hours in this truck stop, and said, "What is that trailer for?" And I said, "Well, we're going to Long Island. We're going to work on homes that were hit by Hurricane Sandy, and we're going to go there. We'll be there for 3 days. We're going to work, and then when we're done, we're going to head back home." "Well, how much do you get paid for that?" I said, "Well, right now the total for me is just about $300, and by the time I get home it will be $500. "You'll get paid $500 for 3 days?" I said, "No, I'll pay $300 to $500 to go, because I have to pay for my own gas, my own lodging, my own food, and any supplies that we need there." Why would anybody do that? Well, because it is a ministry of putting the hands and feet of Christ to the needs in our world. And so, just a note on that, on April 22nd, which is a Saturday, two Saturdays after Easter, we will be having a training right here in our fellowship hall just for you and for anybody else in the Upper Peninsula that wants to come, to be trained as an early response team volunteer. The whole cost of that training is $35. And you get 8 hours of training. You get a t-shirt, a bright green t-shirt. You get a manual, and you get pizza for lunch, all for $35. Plus you get a badge that says you're certified for 3 years. I've been certifiable for over 14 years now, or certified. Well, you decide which one. So I invite you to think about how you can participate with UmCorps, whether it's in bringing in supplies for the kids, the health and hygiene, or the cleaning kits, whether it's to be a part of the early response team, for us to think about a rebuild, remodel, renew, team that goes back afterwards when they're trying to rebuild, or just offering, because we are the hunger and the disaster response arm of the United Methodist Church. And the slogan, or the we are known to be the first in and the last to leave. We make sure that everybody is cared for to the best of our ability. So with that, I invite us to be in prayer. Heavenly God, we give you thanks for this day. And though we may be few in number, we are mighty in heart. And as we come to hear one more direction of how we can be in prayer with, for, and to you, we ask that you will lead us and guide us on this day. Fill our hearts, fill our lives with your grace in Christ our Lord. Amen. So this morning as we come, Diane is at a basketball tournament, and so you get me. Now there are two changes in the bulletin already, and we'll see where the rest goes. The third song in the early set, Holiness, I am not going to use, just simply because my fingers would not go to the right chords this morning, and I am not going to make you have to listen to that. And the last song I have changed from Your Grace is Enough to In the Secret. And so let's stand to sing, I Am Thine, O Lord.
Soul. We come to open our hearts to the movement of the Spirit. let your heart be still, so that you may hear the still small voice that speaks to your soul. Our life is in Christ. Amen. We pray that we may silence our lives enough to listen into the voice of God.
Yes, the dear.
Between what brings us comfort and what you call us to do. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our scripture today comes from the Old Testament of 1 Kings, chapter 19, verses 3 through 14. It's about Elijah. Then he was afraid. He got up and fled for his life and came to Beersheba, which belonged to Judah. He left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a solitary broom tree. He asked that he might die. It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under the broom tree and fell asleep. Suddenly an angel touched him and said to him, "Get up and eat." He looked, and there at his head was a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. He ate and drank and lay down again. The angel of the Lord came a second time, touched him and said, "Get up and eat, or the journey will be too much for you." He got up and ate and drank. Then he went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mount of God. At that place he came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind, and after the wind an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away."
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, hear us as we pray. As we have been working our way through Lent, we have been searching and seeking and finding different ways to pray, different things to do for prayer. And yet, as we come, we always know that there is something more or something deeper that we can look to. And so as we come this day, speak to us as we seek one more way to get deeper in prayer, to hear your voice more clearly. Lord, listen to your children praying. Amen. Now, Elijah wasn't sure what to do. He was running for his life. He just wanted to hear God's voice, and he was afraid that before he did, he was going to get killed. Now, if that isn't enough to make somebody want to bow down and pray, then I'm not sure what is. But he wanted to pray, not so that he could tell God what God needed to hear from him. He wanted to pray and hear God's voice so that he could hear how he could be used for God's kingdom. And that is really what being in prayer is all about. That of coming to God to listen and hear what God has to say. Now, sometimes we, as we found, we have different ways of trying to come to God, and there are a lot of things that get in the way, and as we try to come toward God in prayer, we can put all the roadblocks and barriers up as we could find. Elijah was in a cave hiding for his life, and God spoke and said, come on out. And there as he stood at the entrance of the cave, a mighty storm came, and God's voice wasn't in the storm. How often do we want to hear God's voice in the thunder and the lightning and in the things that are there so it makes us feel like God is there? And when the storm was over, an earthquake shook. And if that wasn't enough to think that God might be coming, God was not there. His voice was still silent. And then a fire came. And in the fire, the raging fire, we know about fires, don't we? We can see we have heard about the forest fires across our country and across, because there are so many, and they can cause all kinds of damage, and they're powerful. And in that, Elijah thought, it's got to be here. And yet the voice of God was still silent. And then a silence came that was so deep. You ever had one of those silences, one of those times when everything became so silent you could hear the silence? It just kind of resonates within you. And in that silence came the voice of God. What are you doing? Well, I came to talk to you and to listen to you, God. And God spoke. You know, the most important thing that we got to get, if we can learn anything in this season of Lent, it's to go to a place where we can find the silence to listen, find that place where all of the distractions are gone, all of the noise, all of the movement, all of the things of life have just settled. I was listening to a person talk the other day. And they said that they were sitting out in the woods where it became so quiet that he could hear the trees speaking to each other and the insects joining in community. Now, when I heard that, I thought, okay, yeah, when the wind blows, we can hear that. Have you ever sat there in the woods or somewhere and just heard the sounds of nature that are so precious, and you begin to listen? When we were at Millville, the property behind the parsonage was cropped. One year it was corn, the next year it was soybean, the next year it was winter wheat, and it would make its circular, I'm not sure if I got the order right, but it was rotated around. And every year, right around the 4th of July, if you went out at night when it was quiet, you could hear the corn growing. People would say, "You can what?" Said, "Yeah, you can hear the corn growing because the stalks are cracking and growing as they get larger and larger." And it was the most amazing thing you'd hear. You'd sit there and tick, 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 tick. It'd be all over this 15-acre field. Back then, I could walk through a field and not fear falling down, or if I did fall down, I could get back up. And I went out and sat in the middle of the field, in the middle of the corn, and just listened to its surrounding. Yes, I know I'm odd, but you know, that's one of those things. If you ever get a chance in the middle of the summer, when the corn, after it reaches that knee high by the 4th of July, or wherever it gets up here, if it gets grown up here, I haven't figured that one out. Go and sit in the middle of a cornfield and listen to the corn growing. So it is in that kind of silence that we have to go. Now, we can try and force the silence upon ourselves, and sometimes that works. Now, sometimes it doesn't. I was in charge of the clergy spiritual life retreat, and we were at Our Lady of Fatima Retreat Center down at Notre Dame University, and it was for the, at that time, the Albion District, and there were about 30 of us that would come each year and go, and that year I was in charge of finding the person. I asked Sister Joan Marie Smith, who was one of the professors at my seminary, whom I had met only twice, to come and be our speaker. And she came in and she goes, "Now," when she sent the note, she goes, "We're going to take an opportunity for some silence." Now, you have to think about this. This is 30 clergy who get together usually for 3 days in this retreat center. There's a pool table in the back basement. It's usually during the time of the year when a Notre Dame basketball game is going on, and you can, they will get us tickets. There's all kinds of things that are happening. And we walk in, and at dinner she says, "Enjoy your conversation now." Because until noon, this was Monday at dinner, until Wednesday at noon when you leave, you can't speak. Okay, now, the majority of us who were there were all extreme extroverts. Otherwise known as, we can't think without talking. We can't manage life without talking. We can't do anything without talking. And we're sitting there trying to figure out, how do you ask somebody to pass the salt? And as we were trying to figure this out, she would walk up and go, "You're talking." I said, "It wasn't out loud." She goes, "I could hear you whisper." The funniest thing was there were about 6 or 7 of us that usually did a round table of playing pool down in the basement. We'd started about 9 o'clock when things were over. She decided she was going to come down and play with us. Now, trying to play pool without doing any talking, laughing, or anything else, when you've got some clowns like us, was just hilarious. In fact, she even broke a smile a couple of times and started chuckling because we were doing our best. And then she began to teach us about being in silence. That silence isn't what it's about. It's about emptying ourselves for listening. Now, when we think about contemplative prayer, we think about silence, we think about being quiet, we think about taking that time, and we hear of some of the monasteries and some of the I don't want to call them nunneries because that's not what they, whatever they are, where the nuns live. Convents, that's what it is. It was right there earlier. And some of them take a vow of silence. You wouldn't get me in a place like that because I wouldn't be able to survive. But these folks seek out the silence to listen. But how do we know what contemplative prayer is? We can hear people say, well, I need to contemplate on this. Well, if I need to contemplate on something, it means I need to think about something in silence. I need to focus on that. To contemplate means to focus on something that you need to understand. That's why there's the old saying about, you know, oh, that guy's just over there contemplating his navel, which means he's asleep, looking down. But contemplating means that we are going to silence to think about and focus on something. And as we contemplate on something, our mind is focused and being used to put that to work. And so we think, well, if that's not what contemplative prayer is about, what is contemplative prayer? Maybe it's about meditation. Well, meditation goes... It uses silence, but meditation is a call to emptying ourselves and trying to find that place where there is nothing there so that we just find that emptiness and everything can flow away. We can meditate on something, we can focus, we can if you notice those, the different religions and the different groups that meditate, they oftentimes will use a single word or a tone, and you know where we hear, you know, so that they can block out and go into a sense of nothingness, a sense of emptiness, a sense where they can let everything go so it can be filled up again. But meditation is not about listening. Meditation is about emptying. So contemplative prayer is not about contemplating, which means to focus on something. It's not about meditation, which means to empty ourselves, to have nothing there. Contemplative prayer is to go into quiet so that we can listen. To listen. To go searching for the quietness. Not to search for emptiness, not to focus on what we're about, but to search for the quietness so that we can hear God's voice. That we can hear God's voice. It means going to that deep place. It means finding our place where we pray while we're going so that I can move into my heart. As I move into my heart, take all of its brokenness away, so that I can feel your presence there. Lord, speak to me so that I can hear you in my deepest soul. In that place where you will speak in the quiet that is so quiet that you can hear it. I was in Washington, D.C. and was there for a week, and we were studying prayer. And one of the groups that was teaching was a group that owned a retreat center. And they just said, well, we're going to go to the retreat center for the day. And they came, and we had about an hour at the beginning where we talked about what the day was going to be about. And then they said, okay, you've got until lunch, and at lunch you can come back. And then we'll be done at 4:30. Oh, by the way, don't talk to anybody. This is twice I've been thrown into those situations where I'm not supposed to speak for 8 hours or more. How in the heck do you do that? I mean, that's just insane. And she goes, you know, and as you are out, you can go on, you can walk, you can sit by the pond, you can go sit in the chapel, you can sit wherever you would like to, you can walk, you can go, you can sleep if you want, but that isn't going to do you any good, because we want to find that place where we are able to empty ourselves of our busyness, so that we can listen to God. The morning was really rough. Those of us, there were about 9 of us on this retreat, and we got out there, and we went out, and we were doing our best to stay away from each other. As we'd see somebody walking, we'd try and hide so we wouldn't break their concentration, and they'd try and hide so that they wouldn't break ours. And when we got to lunch, the person who was running it said, you know, I'll bet you guys had a really hard time figuring out what to do with the 3 hours we just gave you. So don't go and try and just be quiet. But don't go out and speak. Go out and speak in your quietness to God. And let your words be few but focused. Lord, listen to the needs that are in my heart, and yet I come not to tell you what my needs are, but to listen to what you want me to hear. See, they were trying to get us past that laundry list. They were trying to get us past that place where we couldn't figure out what we needed, and to actually go to that place where Elijah was, where he was in the cave, and he was hiding, and he was waiting for God's voice to be in the powerful, and the storm came, and there was nothing, and the earthquake came, and there was nothing, and the fire came, and there was nothing, and then there was silence. And as he was in the silence, and he had been waiting to hear the voice of God, the voice of God spoke. Now, what does that take? It takes giving ourselves over to God, saying, God, I don't want to be in control of this right now. I want you to have control. I don't want to be the one that's telling the person what to do. I want to be the one who hears. I don't want to be the one who's controlling the situation. I want to be in a place where there is no control except for openness, so that I may hear your voice. The afternoon was very interesting because we all got out there and we all found a place, and going there and having something to focus where we could then go and say, Lord, I don't know how to do this, and they're telling me that the best way to do it is to be quiet, and I don't know how to be quiet. And Lord, I want to hear your voice, but I can't hear your voice if I'm talking, so would you help me to keep my mouth shut? I'm sure that in the middle of that, God was going, oy vey, I've never been able to get you to keep your mouth shut. And yet, by the end of that afternoon, when we all came back at 4:30, we all had a place where we heard the voice of God. It might have been very quiet. It might have been only a partial place where we could feel God's presence, where we could feel a sense of Him moving in us. We didn't hear, nobody said they heard any audible voices. But we all could feel the presence nudging us where we needed to go. So when we come, if we are seeking that deeper life of faith, if we are coming to God and we are saying we want to go deeper and seek His presence, we want to go deeper and do what He needs us to do and be who He needs us to be, we need to come with ears and minds and hearts and souls that are open. This is why they say contemplative prayer can't be done in 10 minutes. It takes time to open ourselves up. Some people, it takes a lifetime. Some of the desert fathers and mothers from back in the 3rd, 4th, 5th century would go and they would spend 6 months in a cave, in quiet, having no one to speak to at all. One of the things that they were required to do was that they were required to come in at least every 6 months so that they could, so those who were in charge of their spiritual life could make sure that they had not gone crazy in the silence. This is really why they had to come back, because some people just go crazy. So I'm not asking you to go deep. I'm asking you to spend some time. But I'm going to ask you to take it by step. If you want to begin to listen for what God has to say, you just want to be open to whatever God has to do, wants for you in your life, begin with 15 minutes. Well, anybody can do 15 minutes. You know, that was only 30 seconds that I held us in silence there for a little bit earlier. But try 15 minutes and just keep trying to, God, open my heart and open my soul that I may hear your voice. And as you begin to get comfortable with that, add some time. And as you begin to get comfortable with that, maybe add a half an hour. As you get comfortable with a half an hour, add an hour. If you get comfortable with an hour, add another half an hour. Because it is in that incremental time that when we keep going back, we begin to soften our hearts. We begin to let God remold them. Melt me, mold me, fill me, use me. Spirit of the living God, come afresh on me. That's what contemplative prayer is all about. And it calls us to surrender to the one who gives us life itself. And now, these aren't really exciting sermons about prayer, but they are important for us to be able to go deep. They don't always have the funny stories and all those kinds of things, but I want you to learn something there about what does it mean to go deeper into our lives so that we are more solidly connected the one and only God who gave to us His Son, who came to live and minister and speak to us, and who gave Himself so much that He went to the quiet place. Jesus was healing, and he was preaching. And when night came, he went to a quiet place, and the disciples got all excited because they couldn't find him, because he was in a quiet place in spending time with God. And wouldn't that be something if we could do that? So as we come today, I invite you to take an opportunity. Don't forget the labyrinth is back there. It's great to walk. I've been trying to walk in it at least every other day, just to see what God is speaking to me about on different things in my life. And then go and try and clear your clutter. Get rid of all that stuff that's in your heart and your mind. Put it away the way it needs to. So it's not an easy and quick process, but it's something that we need to learn. And I can say in one place in my world that there's very little clutter, and that is in my prayer life. There may be clutter everywhere else. And if you follow me, some people have told me that I'm a living Big Ben because I don't know where I set things down and I don't always get things finished and put away. But when it comes to prayer, the most satisfying place in our lives is when we are able to go deeper and feel the presence of God and see Him face to face. I invite you to stay seated as we sing I Surrender All, and let this be a song of prayer. Now, one of the things I'm going to ask of you, though, is to you pay attention to the words, and I'll pay attention to getting the right chords. If we do that, we'll make it to the end, we hope. Thank you.
As I read the list of joys and concerns, your responses listed in your bulletin are on the screen. There are quite a few today. We have a concern for Ashley Still from Karen Graham that the pain and swelling for her periodontal surgery will go away. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
A concern for Emily Miller from Judy Smith for health concerns. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
A concern for Kelsey Grigg and her dad, Gordy Grigg Sr. Kelsey is recovering from COVID pneumonia, and Gordy is hospitalized at Marquette Stepdown Unit. Does he have COVID pneumonia also, Judy?
No.
Okay. And those are from Judy. So, Lord, in your mercy. Another concern for Linda and Scott Quayle for their health issues from Judy Smith. Lord, in your mercy. For Elia's little sister Marley, Marley has been sick with RSV for a while, okay? And she's been quite sick, but she now has medicine, so we're going to pray that that medicine works and she feels better. Lord, in your mercy. And Elia also would like us to pray for her dog, Marley, who is in heaven. Lord, in your mercy. And a concern from Dick Derby for Eric for healing from depression. Lord, in your mercy. Another concern from Dick Derby for Cheryl, Audrey, Kathy, and Tom, who need healing from cancer. Lord, in your mercy. A concern from Pastor Bob for his friend Larry Ruby, who fell from a ladder and broke his hip, and we will pray for successful surgery. Lord, in your mercy. A concern for the family of Chatter Horosky, who passed away this week. We pray for peace and comfort for them. That's from Cookie Holmgren. Lord, in your mercy. And a concern for Vance, Stacy, and Lindy, for health concerns from Barb Polamacki. Lord, in your mercy. And a concern from Dorothy Kuhn for Anne Marie, Bruce, and Brian for their ongoing health problems. Lord, in your mercy.
As we continue to move towards Lent, O Lord, listen to our hearts as we seek to pray. Show us that there are different ways to find you, even though you know how to find us, and that there are different ways to listen for you, but that you always listen to us, and that in the midst of our life and our living, that we may find the hope of a new day, because you are hope through your Son, Jesus the Christ. And there are many things that are going on in our lives, in our worlds, in our church, and in disasters, and injustice so numerous that it is hard to imagine how you are able to give to us the comfort you give. For if we had that much to deal with in our lives, we would be overpowered. And yet your greatness and your love reminds us that we can find you in the secret and quiet place. Speak to our hearts as we come. Speak to us so that we may know who we are and whose we are. Speak to us so that we know what we are to do and how we are to respond to people and how we are to greet them in your grace and your love. Show us your ways so that we may walk with you and hear your voice. Come to us, O Lord, as we come this day. Listen to our needs. Listen to our joys. And then open us up to hear your voice and to feel your presence. We ask that you will guide us toward you through your Son who gave everything for us, that we may come directly to you. We lift up his name and pray his prayer that we might bring honor and glory to your name. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue to worship now through the presentation of God's tithes. Closer to you as we seek to open ourselves in prayer, we ask that you will fill us with a sense of your grace and love and speak to our hearts that we may know you even more. Amen. The song that I'm going to be leading us through is called In the Secret Place, and you have the chorus up there, so when you hear me begin singing the chorus, if you know it, join in. If you don't know it, listen. If you want to know it, try and sing. And whatever happens, though, we're going to praise God. Thank you. is never easy. But staying on the surface takes us nowhere. As we seek to find God more deeply in our lives, go now and open your heart to those deep places where God is searching, seeking, and finding you. Go now in God's peace. Blessed day.